Welcome to today's episode and our program, You and Your Health, on Innovation First 06 TV. I am Feshayo Adeyemo, and I'll be your host on today's program. On today's episode of the program, we'll be talking about our mental health. We'll be discussing basically on stress, anxiety, and depression. For every human being, mental health is very important at every stage of one's life. When someone is experiencing mental health breakdown, it can affect every aspect of the person's life. According to World Health Organization, WHO, mental health is a state of well-being in which an individual realizes his or her abilities, can cope with the normal stresses of life, is able to work effectively and fruitfully, and is able to make a contribution to his or her society. According to research on mental health disorder, there is a discrimination in the society. The society have their own view on what mental health is. Some people believe that people with mental health disorder is more harmful to themselves than to others. To lend credence to our topic of discussion today, we are joined with a renowned medical practitioner whose area of specialization is on mental health. And I am certain that by the end of the program today, you and I would know what the indices of mental health are. Before I introduce our guest, let us go on a short musical break. We'll be right back.
Smile, you recording?
Slamming Bentley doors like we invented doors. 20 years ago, we drove Bentley and Zars. We're drinking Cristal in.
Yeah.
Kept the tray on me like Chris Paul in. Drinking Ace of Spades like it's Codeine now. Trying to put a million on the whole team now. Push through the pain so we can see new life. So all the ladies having babies see a sacrifice. Mama had four kids, but she's a lesbian. Had to pretend so long that she's a thespian. Had to hide in the closet so she medicate. Society shame and the pain was too much to take. Cry tears of joy when you fell in love. Don't matter to me if it's a him or her. I just wanna see you smile through all the hate. Maria Antoinette, baby, let her meet Kate.
Bad times turn to good memories.
Smile.
Even when I'm gone and you remember me.
Smile.
Good times never fade away.
Smile.
Even if I'm not with you here today.
Smile.
Good morning, evening, friend. Here's your friendly announcer.
Far Strapist, my name did not get called. Bet before I go, I put a billion on the board. Hall of Fame, hope I did it all without a pen. Y'all knew that was coming, I had to remind y'all again, huh? Flying paper planes through the projects. Now the whole project's on my check.
Welcome back to the show, You and Your Health, on Innovation First 06 TV. Today we'll be talking about our mental health, how to deal with stress, anxiety, and depression. Our guest on the program today is a medical doctor and a psychiatry specialist. Who will be enlightening us on how to deal with stress, anxiety, and depression. We have with us Dr. Wolabi Kayode Ayoda as our guest on the show today. You are welcome, sir.
Absolutely.
Can you kindly introduce yourself, sir?
Yes, I'm Kayode Wolabi, a mental health nurse. That's me.
Thank you very much.
I've been working as a mental health nurse for a long period of time, about 5-15 years period now.
Sir, as a medical doctor and a psychiatry specialist that you have, who is specialized in the diagnosis and treatment of mental health disorder. Sir, can you please tell us what mental health is and what is mental health disorder?
Okay. When you're talking about mental health, there are a lot of things that's embedded in mental health. But basically, when you're talking about mental health, you talk about the ability of an individual to cope with life, stresses, challenges that happens to everybody in life. That's what mental health is all about. That is the ability of an individual to cope effectively life challenges, stress, and all those ones. That's what they call mental health. When you're talking about mental illness, when there is a problem, when the individual is unable to cope effectively and efficiently with life challenges, that's when the person breaks down, the person is unable to maintain balance. That's why they say they have mental illness. That's what's the difference between the two. It's your coping ability that defines you as having a mental health, the inability to cope, what defines that individual as inability as having mental illness.
Thank you, sir. Our next question is, sir, can you tell us, from our research, we found out that there are various types of mental health disorder.
Yes.
Sir, can you please enlighten us on the various types of mental disorder that we have?
Yes, we have a lot of them. It could be categorized as having major ones. Some, I mean by those ones that require admission, that require treatment, and all the major mental illness, like cases like schizophrenia, depression, those are regarded as major ones. And right on, as far as minor ones, we call them neurosis. like your anxiety, all those ones, neurosis, all those kind of few ones, phobias and others, that most of the cases can be treated on a patient basis with natural sport. Minor mental illness. So basically, you can categorize mental illness into two groups, that is the major one and the minor one. At the same time, you can have another classification, as we have what we look at as a functional ones, and we have the other side. I'm referring to those that have something to do with the imbalance of chemical within the brain that can affect and can produce an individual to that. That's all refers to as functional, and the other one can be referred to as affective disorders. That is something that has something to do with the mood. What happens to the mood of an individual? That's the other. There are a lot of classification, but it depends on what you actually wanted to get from your definition of this.
Thank you very much. Sir, are you not saying that mood swing is also a type of mental health disorder?
Yes, when you're talking about swinging of mood, is a manifestation or a symptom of a particular mental disorder. It meaning that the person can move from low, when the person is depressed, to an elation when the person is high. So it's possible. It may not be a particular mental disorder, but be a symptom of a particular mental disorder.
So that will bring us to our next question. Sir, for someone who is just experiencing a mental health breakdown, what are the symptoms to look for in such person?
As we said the other time, there are a lot of mental illnesses, and each of them have different characteristics. So if it be minor ones, you can see from the appearance. The appearance also give you a lot of insight into the worldview of that individual. The dressing, the way the person appears, may have an insight, okay, maybe there's a problem. The emotion, movement, the activities, person may be a bit restless. Sometimes person may be a bit down, may be low, or being in a stupor. Maybe the person is in a state where it does not react to the environmental stimulus. So those are the things that you can find in an individual as having mental disorders. Then there could be other issues like we call it hallucination, when somebody is having false sense perception. It could be visual, like seeing somebody that does not exist. It could be auditory, all sort of thing, all sort of sensory distortion. As well, those are the ones that is really open for most of the public to be able to see.
Thank you very much, Doctor. Sir, can we say that stress causes mental health problems?
Yeah, when you're talking about stress, there are a lot of issues with stress. Stress has been implicated in so many health problems, not only mental illness. So the effect of it has a lot of effects on human beings. Now, if you have said the other time, stress are part of normal life. But there's no way you can live a life without stress. But your ability to be able to cope with those stress that make the difference. Like I've said the other time, stress also be implicated in other health issues like hypertension and other issues. So stress could also be a contributing factor that makes somebody have mental illness. So if the person is unable to cope, then they start to break down. But as long as you're able to cope, then you're able to maintain your balance.
Sir, can we exactly say that stress is an illness? And is stress connected to our emotions?
Yes, we can say stress is an illness because that's what everybody goes through. So it cannot say it's an illness. But stress in one way or the other is connected to our health. So once you're able to cope, then you are having a very good life. But inability to cope, that's where we have the problem. Even presenting as a presenter is also a stress to youth. Coming up to do so many other things is a stress itself. Even a child growing up, learning to eat, learning to walk is a stress to children. Getting married is also a stress. Getting divorced is also a stress. You understand that? So there are positive as negative. But the ability to be able to cope is what is the defining factor as far as stress is concerned. So whether we like it or not, you have to go through stress in life. In fact, life will not be a worthwhile if there are no stress. If all you want, you need in life, you able to get it cheaply, then you don't need to bother, you don't need to stress yourself, you don't need to do anything. But because things are sometimes a bit difficult, that's why there also is need for you to be able to define the coping mechanism and be able to absorb those shocks when they come.
Thank you very much, sir. This is a very knowledgeable information, and I am certain that our viewers at home are getting enlightened from what you've said so far.
Okay.
We'll be going on a short break, but we'll be bringing people's opinion to us on stress, anxiety, and depression. Stay glued. We'll be right back.
My name is Promis. I started having the fear of relating with people, of meeting people in a social context when I was in 100 level. It came so strongly then, because as an 100 level student, I was still inexperienced, I was inexposed, and you know, I had a lot of things going through my mind. I had heard a lot about people that when once you get to school, you face cultists, you face classes, you face a lot of things. So I was very, very anxious in my heart. And that coupled with my own fear of relating with people, because then in 100 level, I saw a lot of people as being over my own class because of where I came from. I could see people from Lagos, from big towns. So then I was very, very anxious of relating with them, thinking of what they would say. If I greet this person and he or she does not answer me, how would I react? I would surely feel so bad. Because then I was someone that little things hurt a lot. So I was very, very afraid of relating with people because of the fear of what they would say to me.
All right. So was there a stigma about being anxious, or did you speak to anyone about it, or what did the environment per se do to you being anxious?
Well, the first feedback I got from being anxious, especially socially, was people thought that I was a proud person actually, because I was afraid of relating people, so I was always on my own. So they thought that I was a proud person, and it affected me in some ways. I changed people's perspective about me, but I had to talk to some people. Okay, how would I go about this? And one thing that is still so fresh in my mind that the person I talked to then said to me was that it is until you build your own self-confidence that you can be able to get confident enough to relate with people around you. So once I heard that statement, then I was able to convince myself that it was something I could do. And then I was going to contest for the PRO of my faculty, public relations officer. So it also boosted my confidence in relating with people. Well, that happened very recently, in fact this year, and that was during the last faculty election. I contested for the president of my faculty here in school. That was February. And you know, I was already so sure and confident that by the grace of the Almighty, I was going to win that election, because I had done a lot. I had started my work since last year, you know, only for the election day to come. And after the electioneering process, I was told that I was not the winner. So I was so stressed to the core, like I got almost depressed. Thank God for the words of people that were close to me, like my mom, my dad, my family and friends. So during that election period, I was so stressed and I was almost depressed that I even lost the election eventually. So I was so stressed and I was almost experiencing depression.
The stress in campus, I can't say everything is a bed of roses you get, because dealing with stress in school, like, it's something you have to like deal with personally. But with the kind of person I am, I hang out with friends, watch movies, listen to music, I play around. So I think with that kind of personality I have, I've been able to deal with stress in those aspects.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, have you ever been anxious about something?
Yes, I've been anxious about a lot of things, not just something.
And as those things you've been anxious about, have they affected you?
Yes.
In what way? How?
It has affected me both in the positive and the negative side.
Okay.
Yes. In the positive side, whereby maybe what I'm anxious about came in at a very particular point in time. And the negative side may be like, you know, when I'm anxious about something and I did not get what I want, so negative. At some point in time, I was moody and all, but like I said earlier, what kind of person I am.
Stress is something common, because it happens to every human being. But even if I can't remember the ones that's been happening to me, at least I can still remember the one who happened yesterday. You know, when you face a lot of difficulties in handling some assignments, and you are dealing with the assignment not knowing that, you know, sometimes what your ignorance of will give you problem. You'll be like, wow, what's this? And then the stress will just come in. You feel that your brain is pumping, or you want to get explode. You have to leave what you are doing and then do some other things. So generally, like what happened to me yesterday, I was given an assignment to do, And you know, it was a new assignment and we have to develop one kind of a software. So to create the software is a barrier, to use the software as an orthography is a barrier. So I have to go on YouTube, waste my data, and all these things developed to a lot of ethic problem and stress to me. Honestly, I have to drop my laptop, relax, sleep, wake before I could gather something. So stress can come in any ways. Fact, not only mental, it affects my mental, my physical, my emotion, my thinking. Everything is blunt. You just have to drop whatever I'm doing. Yes, you see, you don't, when you stress your stress, you develop more problems.
Yes, I have been depressed. Okay, there are a lot of scenarios actually, but I can just point out to one, which is the time I was seeking for admission. Yes, I was having admission issues because I wrote JAMB for 3 years and it was the third time already. At first, before I wrote JAMB, I had the fear of, would I pass the JAMB? I was JAMB. What are the questions there? Though I studied for JAMB, but I was scared. I didn't even know what the outcome would be. I had a lot of fear. Plus, my mates that we graduated, we finished secondary school together. Most of them were already in school. And the fact that they were in school already was already causing a drift and a distance between our conversations. Because I wasn't expecting, though I was expecting that we should still be talking. We still be conversing, but I think they no longer had that time. It was added to my depression. Plus, when I wrote JAMB, the result was okay, 220 something. So it was okay, and then the school I opted out for, it was okay, but not okay for my course, yes. Because I wanted to go for law, so it didn't go. And I wrote JAMB the second year again, hoping that okay, things will be better. The same thing, I still went for law, and I was like, no. Let me change this to English. Of it, I changed to English and did that work. But during the time of the depression, it was very bad.
Welcome back once again to the show, You and Your Health, showing live from Universal 406 TV. I am still your host, Feishaye Adeyemo. And as we've seen earlier, that indeed, people are really victims of stress, anxiety, and depression. But we are still here with our guest, Dr. Owolabi Kayode Ayoda, who is still enlightening us on what stress, anxiety, and depression is. Sir, can we say anxiety is also the same thing as social phobia?
Well, there is a thin line between anxiety and social phobia. Phobia is one of anxieties, is another one we have. Anxiety, there are a lot of them, as I've said the other time, there are a lot of minor mental illnesses. Most of the time, the management of those may not really require someone being admitted in a hospital or inside the hospital. But phobia is part of an anxiety. There are specific fear that people have. Specific, like some people have some specific fear to open spaces. That's a phobia. If you have a particular fear towards speaking up only, we call it social phobia. So there are specific ones. But the anxiety is a general thing that combines all forms of phobia. So it's a subgroup under anxiety.
So anxiety can be classified as the name for all sorts
of fear of anything.
Thank you, sir. So the next question we'll be asking is that, what causes depression and how can one take care of a depressed person?
So when I'm talking about depression, it's a mood disorder. We call it mood disorder. Meaning the person could be down, but the same time the person can be up. So when the person is down, that's why you say the person is having depression. So what causes depression? Just like many mental illnesses, the cause of most of mental illness are unknown. That means we say this idiopathic, that is not known. Nobody knows what caused those things. But there are things that could be people could attribute to it, and we describe those things as predisposing factors or precipitating factors. And when we're talking about that predisposing factor, we're talking about those things that are present within an individual that makes somebody liable to have that kind of illnesses, whether it's depression or any form of mental illness. So, in some people, some chemicals could be low. I mean, some neurotransmitters in our brain, when they are low, it could predispose an individual to depression. When they are too high, it could predispose them to a particular kind of mental illness. Then the other aside is the precipitating factors. What we talk about other factors that are not within the individual, like stress that you mentioned the other time, that can also be a cause. Like someone described mental illness as a loaded gun. when you loaded a gun in a corner and nobody pulled the trigger, you know, it could be hid there for about 1,000 years. That's how mental illness is. Even when that person have a factor that inherent in that individual that make that person to be able to have mental illness, as long as the person is not stressed beyond that level, the person will not break down. So that is the relationship between the two causes that we can say. Though, as I've said the other time, there are no known causes, but those are the things that people can categorize. And I've said the other one, you talk about genetics too. The heredity, you cannot underplay that power of heredity. So if you have a parent or sibling or anybody that's very close who has have experienced depression before, there's chances that that person, a sibling or a relation with that person, can also have that. That's also part of predisposing factors. Having somebody or relation who has suffered from a kind of mental illness or depression before, that can also be a cause. But it's not automatic, just like I said the other time, it's not automatic that because the parent is having mental illness that the children must have. It's not automatic. It still depends on what the abilities of an individual to be able to cope in life that brings the difference.
All right, sir. How can one take care of a depressed person?
Yeah, there are different ways of taking care of a depressed person. If someone is depressed, in most cases, it's warrant that person to be taken to a hospital, that person will be examined and treated, and then the person goes home. That would be part of the medical treatment. But as generally, what can we do is by getting closer to them, being a confidant to them, then giving assistance. Most of the time, when people are depressed, they are having problems, they are overwhelmed with life challenges and they're unable to cope. But if they're able to get help, automatically they would be up. So getting closer to them, being friends, and supervising them with medication, assist them with medication, that would go a long way in reducing the effect of depression of an individual. And that will assist this person to be able to come out of depression. But in most cases, when somebody is depressed, it's always good that the person is taken to the hospital where the person will be better, will be examined and be given proper treatment. Depression. Most cases, most people get out of depression and live a normal life. In most cases, the chances of the person getting back to life is very, very high, unlike other mental illnesses.
Thank you very much, sir. Okay. It's a pleasure having you on our program today.
Okay.
And we hope that when next we beckon on you, you would oblige us.
Yeah.
And to our viewers at home, we are so grateful for you to stay tuned to our program. But before we draw the curtains of today's program, let us bring to us the speech of a counselor who would be enlightening us on how to handle stress, anxiety, and depression. We'll be right back.
So for someone that is suffering from depression, what advice would you give to that person?
Thank you so much. Depression is real, very real, and is a mental illness. And in this part of the world, it's only that it's very unfortunate that we downplay it. We downplay depression so much. And a lot of things could be responsible to make people to be depressed. When the depression is so much, sometimes we do refer such even to the psychiatrist, that is, they will have them to go and do hormonal profile to know what is wrong with in the body, to know whether there is hormonal imbalances and what's the medication that can be prescribed to manage such a thing. So depression is very real. And a lot of things can cause depression. Breakup, that is emotional
breakdown,
can cause depression. Society can even cause depression. Finance can cause depression. Failure can cause depression, apart from hormonal imbalances that I talked about. Take for instance, somebody that has like 10 houses before that is getting renters from those houses, and boom, the bank came in and they seized all the, because such a person could not pay back. And somebody that has been a landlord now become a tenant, it can toy with such person mentality, or somebody that lost all her children in the day due to accidents. The person, people will be saying, you know, in this part of the world, we have a lot of ways that we do use to console. They will bring up all sort of past sin and the rest of it. And after a little time, they will believe that such a person is okay now, and everyone will go back to Israel house. The person that such a thing happens to will now, even people may be around such a person, because it will seem as if the person is going on, that is getting drowned. It's like crying out for help that people cannot hear. It's like that. It leads to suicidal ideation, suicidal tendency, suicidal thoughts, what have you. You'll be looking at the person, and because it's mental health illness, it's not written on the head like this. You'll be looking at the person, and this person is looking fine. But inwardly, I won't mention name, one of the Nollywood actress was crying out recently, and I'm depressed. But because it's not written on the headline, somebody that has hypertension, that has stroke, it's not written on the head like somebody that has cancer and did chemotherapy and the hair receded. You know, when you see such a person, you know that something is wrong with the body. Yeah. But depression, except if you really know the person before the person start to get the, before the victim start to, or let me see, before the patient start to get depressed, that's when you can see that somebody is depressed. But if you don't know the person, if it's the first time you are meeting the person and you don't have one-on-one conversation with the person, you may not think of any, because you've not known before and the after of the person. So somebody that has been up and down, life of the party, now getting withdrawn, you ask question, you say, so what do you say? Lost in thoughts, you have to drag and drag and drag before the person can contribute. And sometimes when they are contributing, there will not be synergy, there will not be logics in what the person is saying. Depression is setting in, and it will be affecting every relation such a person will be taking in life. They will just start crying. Sometimes they start crying.
Please,
stop. Welcome back once again. And I am certain that we've all gained something from the program today. Now, it is important for us to take care of our health, because your mental health is important to me, to you, and to the society. A very big thank you to the executive producers, Mr. Vio Adefemi and Dr. Mary Okocha, and to my amiable producer, Alabi Abdulmumin, and to my floor and sound manager, Akinriola Precious, to the camera and lightsman, Ibunaize Joseph, to my welfare one and continuity, Adebayo Kabirat, and to my welfare two and logistics, Richard Fitt. I am Feshayo Adeyemu, and I am your host on today's program. See you same time, same station, next time. Bye.